Hello, and welcome to this presentation discussing real and complex modulation. In this video, we'll first look at what modulation is and some common types of modulation. Then we'll dig into phase and amplitude modulation and the math behind it in order to introduce the concepts of real modulation and complex modulation. Finally, we'll discuss uses of complex modulation and finish with an example to connect the concepts. First, let's discuss basic modulation. Modulation is the act of changing a carrier signal's properties, such as amplitude, phase, or frequency, in a controlled way in order to transmit data across a channel or to obtain desired signal properties. The process is demonstrated here for a digital communication system. We have a sequence of bits that control our modulator. The modulator responds to each bit, or a sequence of bits, in order to modulate the signal in a specific way to represent those bits. The signal is transmitted across the channel, which could be a coax cable, wireless channel, or optical fiber. After transmission, the modulated signal is demodulated in order to identify the bits that were transmitted. There are many types of modulation techniques that are used. Each type of modulation achieves different trade-offs in spectral efficiency, complexity, power efficiency, noise tolerance, etc. Some of the most commonly used modulation types are given here. Pulse amplitude modulation, called PAM, modulates only the carrier amplitude. PAM can include negative amplitudes as well, which can be seen as a phase shift of 180 degrees. As an example, two-level PAM, often called binary phase shift keying, or BPSK, is used often in serialized interfaces, such as gigabit Ethernet. Of course, the most well-known analog amplitude modulation is that used in AM radio transmission. Phase shift keying, or PSK, modulates only the carrier phase, which results in a constant carrier envelope that achieves good power efficiency. PSK has good noise tolerance and is used in LTE networks when the channel has low signal-to-noise ratio in order to achieve a sufficient bit error rate. Quadrature amplitude modulation, called QAM, modulates both the carrier phase and amplitude, allowing the use of a large number of symbols to greatly increase spectral efficiency, at the cost of reduced power efficiency and more difficult noise requirements. It is one of the most commonly used modulation types today. 256 symbol QAM is used in DOCSIS 3.0 cable systems to achieve high data rates over low noise channels. Frequency modulation modulates the carrier frequency. In digital communications, discrete frequencies are chosen as symbols, each representing a sequence of bits. Other examples include FM radio, of course, and linear frequency modulation, or LFM. LFM is a continuous linear sweep of the carrier's frequency. LFM is typically not used for data transmission, however, it is used in radar systems in order to achieve pulse compression, which improves spatial resolution to allow identification of closely spaced targets. Now, let's walk through the math behind basic phase and amplitude modulation. This is a good example since it is widely used, such as in quadrature amplitude modulation, or QAM. This same basic analysis can be used for all of the modulation types given on the previous slide. It also allows us to demonstrate both real and complex modulation. First, a phase and amplitude modulated carrier can be represented as shown here, where the cosine term serves as the carrier, which is modulated in amplitude by A of t and in phase by theta t. The carrier frequency is represented by F sub c. Making use of the angle sum trigonometric identity allows us to decompose x of t into separate sine and cosine carriers, each modulated in amplitude by a of t and in phase by the respective sine and cosine of the phase modulation function theta t. We can then redefine the amplitude and phase modulation for each carrier as functions, called x sub I of t and x sub q of t. These modulation functions are often referred to simply as I and q. I is the in-phase modulation function, and Q is the quadrature phase modulation function. The term quadrature comes from sine and cosine being 90 degrees out of phase from each other. Now we have this form of X of T, which represents our real-world transmitted signal. Both I and Q modulation functions are real-valued functions, meaning they do not contain an imaginary component, and therefore X of T is a real-valued function, as required for real-world transmission. However, this function can actually represent both real and complex modulation. As a quick note, this transmitted signal is often referred to as a bandpass signal, since it occupies some bandwidth at a carrier frequency, or in other words, the I and Q functions modulate a carrier signal. The bandpass signal can be decomposed into a low-pass modulation function multiplied by a complex exponential carrier. The term low-pass refers to the signal being centered at DC, also called baseband. This new baseband modulation function, X sub BB of T, is formed from the I and Q real-value modulation functions, where Q represents the complex component. It is easy to see that X sub BB of T is a real-value function if X sub Q of T equals 0. When X sub BB of T is real-valued, the result is real modulation. Or, if X sub Q of T is not 0, it is a complex signal which results in complex modulation. We can now relate this new complex baseband modulation function back to the real-valued bandpass transmitted signal, as shown here. X of t is found by multiplying X sub BB of t by a complex exponential, with frequency equal to the carrier frequency, and taking the real part of this product. We call this form of the transmitted signal the analytic equivalent, since its main purpose is to analyze the modulation. Using Euler's formula, and the definition of X sub BB of t, it is easy to see that this definition of X of t is equivalent to the previous definitions. Try showing this equivalence yourself. Essentially, X sub BB of t is simply a time-varying complex number that is controlled by the I and Q modulation functions. Remember that both I and Q are real-valued functions, and X sub BB of t is only complex when the Q function is not zero. Next, we'll demonstrate the benefit of using complex modulation over real modulation. Here's an example of real modulation, taking a cosine wave and converting it to a higher frequency. We often refer to this process as mixing, but it can be viewed as modulating one sine wave with another sine wave. In this case, the baseband modulation function is a cosine wave that is real-valued for all values of time. Or in other words, the Q component is zero. The frequency of the baseband cosine wave is f sub if, where if stands for intermediate frequency. Using Euler's relationship for a cosine, we can describe the cosine wave as a sum of two complex exponentials. Plugging this into the analytic definition of x of t, combining exponential powers, and then using Euler's formula, we can see that the resulting modulated signal is a sum of two real cosine waves at the carrier frequency plus and minus the if frequency. However, only one of these signals is generally desired, and the undesired signal, called the image, must be filtered out. One way to solve this problem is to use complex modulation. So, consider the same scenario, but using complex modulation instead. Here, the baseband modulation function is a complex exponential rather than just a real-valued cosine wave. Using Euler's again, we can see that the complex exponential is just a summation of a cosine and a sine with the sine term multiplied by j. So the in-phase modulation function, or I, is a cosine wave, and the quadrature phase modulation function, or q, is a sine wave. Plugging this complex baseband function into the analytic definition of x of t, combining exponential powers, and using Euler's results in the final modulated signal. The imaginary sine component is removed by the real part function. This new modulated signal contains only the desired signal, with the image signal being attenuated or rejected. Let's try to visualize this example in the frequency domain. In the real mixing case, the first thing to realize is that a real signal, such as a cosine wave, has mirrored positive and negative frequency spectrums. Negative frequencies do not exist in the real world, but do in the analytic world. The same can be said for a real modulated signal, as demonstrated by this shape. Notice that both positive and negative frequency spectrums look the same. When this signal is mixed to a higher frequency, both positive and negative frequency spectrums are mixed up to the carrier frequency. We refer to the two sides of the carrier frequency as the lower sideband and upper sideband. In this case, both lower and upper sidebands contain the same information, which is not very efficient. This scenario is referred to as double sideband, or DSB, transmission, which is the result of real modulation. If we now look at the complex mixing case, where we used a complex exponential as the baseband signal, we can see that the complex sinusoid only exists in the positive frequency space, and the negative image is gone. I could also define the complex exponential to be a negative frequency, meaning that it exists in the negative frequency space and not the positive frequency space. This shows that my positive frequency space is independent of my negative frequency space. My complex modulated signal, as represented by this shape, can then contain different information in the two sidebands. Once I mix it with a complex sinusoid and take the real part, the lower and upper sidebands of the carrier signal are now independent. This is called single sideband transmission, or SSB, since each sideband can transmit unique information. The key benefit is that this allows me to transmit twice as much information over the same bandwidth as real transmission. Now that we've covered the basic math behind complex modulation, let's discuss the two main uses. First, the concept of complex modulation is used in image reject mixers, where real mixing results in both a desired signal and an undesired image signal, which must be filtered out. The use of complex modulation allows inherent rejection of the image signal, as I showed in the complex mixing example. Rejection of the image signal relaxes the analog filter requirements after the mixer. Analog mixers are not able to achieve perfect rejection due to imperfections. However, even a 20 dB reduction in the image signal power results in a significant relaxation of filter requirements. Secondly, complex modulation is widely used in digital communications in order to double the data rate for a given signal bandwidth. This improves spectral efficiency, which is important when bandwidth is limited, such as in wireless communications. Doubling of the data rate is possible because sine and cosine are orthogonal functions, allowing separation of the I and Q components. Since I and Q can be separated, they can contain independent information. Let's look at this use case a bit more. Digital communications uses discrete I and Q values to form symbols. A common way to visualize the complex symbols is the use of a constellation plot, such as this example plot for 16 QAM. The plot maps symbols onto the complex plane. The x-axis represents the magnitude of the real I component, while the y-axis represents the magnitude of the imaginary Q component. Each symbol maps to a sequence of bits in order to transmit information. In the example plot, the bit sequence 1011 maps to the bottom right symbol, represented by the most positive I and most negative Q values. The distance from the origin to a symbol represents the modulated carrier amplitude and can be calculated using Pythagorean's theorem. The phase of the modulated carrier is the angle from the positive I axis to the symbol and can be calculated using the arctangent of Q over I. Now, let's try to connect the dots between what is shown in the constellation plot and the transmitted signal definition shown before. First, consider the 16 QAM constellation plot shown previously. Let's say that we want to transmit across the channel at a carrier frequency f sub c, and we want to send the bits 0011. Looking at the diagram, we can see that bits 0011 are assigned to the bottom left symbol in the bottom right quadrant of the complex plane. This symbol corresponds to I and Q values of 1 and negative 3, respectively. So our baseband modulation function is simply 1 minus J3. Now we can calculate the carrier amplitude and phase using the equations from the previous slide. We find that the amplitude is the square root of 10, and the phase is negative 1.25 radians. Now we can generate the modulated signal in two ways. We could use the calculated amplitude and phase to set the amplitude and phase of the cosine wave, as shown by the top equation. Or, we can use the I and Q values directly from the constellation plot to set the relative amplitudes of the independent cosine and sine terms, as shown by the bottom equation. The resulting signal is the same. However, the second method is the one often used, as it is easier to implement in a digital processor or FPGA. Here are a few constellation plots for various modulation schemes. The first is quadrature phase shift keying, or QPSK, which has four symbols, one in each quadrant of the complex plane. The second is eight-symbol phase shift keying, or 8PSK, which has eight symbols that are separated by 45 degrees. The third is 32 QAM, which doesn't form a perfect square since the square root of 32 is not an integer. Instead, the four corners of the square are removed, which slightly improves the power efficiency and allows mapping of 5 bits to each symbol. The last is 1024 QAM, which is a tightly packed constellation. mapping 10 bits to each symbol for significant data rate increases. It is easy to see that the denser constellations require better noise and distortion performance in order to achieve the same bit error rate, due to the closely packed symbols. However, the constellations with larger spacing between symbols send less bits per symbol and therefore have lower data rates. Many systems allow for on-the-fly changing of the constellation as channel conditions improve or degrade in order to achieve the maximum data rate for a required bit error rate. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching.